Not because you like to say terrible things.
It's almost as if you beat me to say terrible things, then hit record, and then like I don't see anything terrible once the record button's been hit. It's just at the point of you pressing record, they always seem to happen.
Yeah, well, we'll have to keep that on the audio only version this time because I was still putting things together. So, hey, everyone.
Hi.
I'm Bo.
I'm Duncan.
And we haven't seen you in about a month because October is busy as shit.
Yeah, but it turns out, Bo, when you do horror podcasting, mm-hmm. October isn't a great month to do anything else.
Yeah. And, you know, I've had a now 3-year running bad idea.
At least you acknowledge it's a bad idea.
Yeah. I'm like, oh, I'm going to have a little podcast every day about a movie.
Yeah.
And it's fun. I like doing it. It's just, I can't do anything but that.
Yeah.
For that month and made even more complicated by the fact that, you know, there's like school and work and that kind of thing to deal with.
Yeah. But, like you've got things on top of that this year that you didn't have the year before that you could have just said, you know what? Put a pin in it this year. Happen in it. Come back to next year. Never.
So, never say never again, Duncan. That's what I say. Well, I'm trying to get in the spirit because we're the Pink Panther movie we're talking about today, which is the Pink Panther Strikes Again.
Can't wait to talk about this. By the way, this is my favorite one. This is the one that I love because it's the most cartoon out of the lot.
And it's really a James Bond parody as opposed to a Pink Panther.
Yeah, this is like some people are like, you know what? That Austin Powers really see how he just did the Bond thing.
Yeah.
He made it funny and all the rest. Isn't that really smart and refreshing? I'm like, rewind the son of a bitch up, jump back 30 years before, and we've already done it.
Yeah. It is very interesting. I hadn't really thought about it in terms of the Austin Powers stuff. I'm glad you brought that up because that's a really interesting context. But Herbert Lommy is kind of Dr. Evil.
He's 100% Dr. Evil.
in this. But we'll get to all that in a minute. We haven't done a show since Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we were talking offline earlier, like how much fun we had at Halloween and I had to, so the night of Halloween was kind of a bummer because I was in class and that's when all the trick-or-treaters came and I was really excited about that. I was hoping they would do it Saturday night, you know, because it was a weekend. Didn't happen. They did it Monday night on Halloween proper, which is how you should do it.
Yeah.
But I was unable to enjoy any of that.
Yeah.
Because I was too busy learning, you know, linguistics and constituent clauses that can't be moved. And
if it makes you feel any better, like as soon as you're qualified as a teacher, you'll not be able to enjoy anything else again because you'll be busy marking papers. So
you know, yeah, I mean there's that. But here's the thing, Duncan, is I feel like I'm just gonna get the gist of papers that I'm grading.
You'll be fine. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, like, let's look how they are in class. Like, I'll know what
it's like multiple choice, like answers. Like, you just, A, B, right? Maybe C, 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 A, B. You don't need to read them.
Yeah. Look, I'm going to know what grade they deserve by how they treat me.
100%. 100%.
I'm not above rewarding students who just suck up to me. With A's, like, I'm going to be an easy A as long as you're like, oh, have you lost weight, Mr. Ransdell? Yeah. You're like, oh, Billy, you are doing well in this class. which, by the way, so I've almost done, like, I'm, you know, a month out, essentially, from being wrapped up, which is great. And I get periodic emails from the school system here that's like, you done yet? Because
we need teachers
badly. And we're opening a whole new school and we don't have teachers for that son of a bitch either. And the thing that I'm just crossing my fingers for is that I don't get middle school.
So what's middle school then?
Middle school here is 6th through 8th, which would be about, you know, 11 to 13, 12 to 14, that neighborhood. It's
Oh, right. So that's high school for us. So high school, like, so in this country, primary school is from ages 5 through to about 11, and then high school is from 11 through to 18, with the option for kids to drop out at 16.
Okay.
Yeah, so, yeah, once they complete their 4th year of high school, they can officially leave school. But, you know, if you wanted to go in and do, like, university, for example, or even to an extent some college, you kind of need to set at least a minimum of one of the higher years, which is the 5th and 6th years. So
here we have middle school, which is sort of corralling the worst ages all together.
Yeah.
Of like, hey, these are the developmental ages where you're going to be a nightmare.
Yeah.
As a human being, you know, like this is when the hormones are hitting you. It's, you know, like we were talking about earlier, that age when you start to push boundaries of authority and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And so it's segregated where that's middle school, and then high school is, you know, years 9 through 12.
See, that makes a lot more sense, like, over how we do it. So essentially your first and second year in high school, so that'd be ages, once again, 11 through 13,
yeah,
are essentially, you learn you have to sit every subject. So that's English, maths, chemistry, physics, biology, like woodwork, like you study absolutely everything.
Mm-hmm.
And then in your third year, which would be essentially your high school, you get to then choose what classes that you want to do. So you choose 8 classes which make your curriculum up. There are core ones that you can't choose. For example, you must sit maths, you must sit English, you must do a social science, so history, geography, or modern studies. But with that, it's a kind of, you can choose what you want. So you've got the option to take music or not take music.
Yeah.
You've got the option to, like, these sort of things. So you specifically, and that's based around what you want to do kind of longer term. So that third and fourth year, if you were wanting to become an apprentice joiner, for example, you can cater your classes in your third and fourth year to such a way that you would get qualifications to get you into college to do that sort of thing. And then your 5th and 6th year is like a condensed version of that over here. So your final 2 years in high school, if you decide to go on and go on to do further education, you would, I think you only have to choose 5 subjects there. And whatever you get in that is essentially setting you up for university. So the fact that in a lot of respects, that to me seems a bit better to have like a midpoint.
Mm-hmm.
Like section there for that, as opposed to, like, because when kids go into high school, they're in high school, so you're in that building for at the most 6 years amongst everyone else, and it's huge ranges in there. So to me that kind of, I kind of like that system of, right, there's a kind of midway point where, you know, you're getting all your shit sorted out, and then you move into high school proper. So
right, and in theory middle school is also to help you prepare, like, academically as well, because you're going from elementary school to, okay, well, now you need to learn skills. Like, here's how you study, and here's how you're writing papers. And then when you get to high school, all of it's going to be, that's going to be assumed that you know how to do that stuff.
And then
you can do the more focused, you know, like, in with American high schools, it's more like, hey, do you want to go into what are often referred to as industrial arts, like more trade school kind of stuff?
Or do
you want to pursue the academic track, which tends to be like AP classes and that kind of thing, where you can get some early college credit and that kind of thing. So, you know, but
you don't want middle school.
I don't want that. It's probably what's going to happen, because I'm going to be a first year teacher, and they're just like, we're going to throw you to the wolves sort of thing.
In a lot of respects, that might be, it's not desirable, but it might be good from your point of view. Like, get the work, like, whatever you get there at however difficult that is, in some respects, might never be that difficult again.
Well, and my girlfriend's kids are that age. So yeah. I'm not going in without an understanding, and one of them is,
hello,
a
fellow
handful.
Children.
Yeah,
hello, fellow children.
Right. Yeah, so I kind of know what I'm getting, and I've seen, you know, like the boy child, if not the worst kid in the class, is at least in the conversation. you know, despite our best efforts for him not to be, but he is definitely a real pill in the classroom. So it's like, I understand what I'm kind of getting myself into with kids of that stripe. Yeah. And so that's kind of my expectation. So for every kid that's like, oh no, I'm here to learn, I'm going to be like, oh, God bless you, you sweet summer child. Like,
you're going to end up like Eric Cartman, in that episode of South Park where they did, what was it? The song that, what was it, Michelle Pfeiffer movie where she has to go into the hood.
Oh, Dangerous Minds.
Dangerous Minds, you go back, how do I reach these kids?
The stand and deliver thing. The one thing that I am cool with is the idea of bouncing kids right into summer school.
Yeah.
Like, I just don't have any, like, I want all the kids, I'm looking forward to it. You know, I do enjoy being around kids that age, and I like their enthusiasm and all that stuff. But yeah, as soon as they're a problem, it's like, oh, in school suspension, and summer school. Those are the tools at my disposal, and I will avail myself of them. Like, you know, I it's a conversation I have with my girlfriend all the time about the boy child. It's like, you know, I feel so bad for the teachers, and at some point their patience is going to break, and he is going to end up in summer school. And while we're off traveling somewhere, he's going to be stuck with his much more strict grandparents.
Yeah.
Going to summer school while we're off doing something fun. And, you know, I know he's going to just climb up on the cross for that one. But it's like, look, man, you
can only do what you can do. Yeah. Like, you can only raise something so many times before, you know, there is that thing about, like, although my daughter can be too clever for her own good at times, like, she loves her iPad. And, like, that's the tool that I use, as that if you do not do this, the iPad comes off you. And, you know, it's trauma when it comes off her. The little witch is, she's very good at other things, though. She's kind of like, oh, look what I went upstairs and I decided to draw this beautiful portrait. And I'm like, oh, for fuck's sake. Like, she's
going, like, I can't praise you for the thing I was punishing you for.
Like, she's like outside, like, let me see the draw this countryside view here.
Yeah.
Beautiful bit of art that's now hung on the wall. But at the same time, though, there is that thing where, like, she gets the kind of almost the three strike thing of, like, this is the second strike. The third strike, it does come off you.
Yeah.
But when it does come off her, it is that, like, there's almost like she senses like a degree of betrayal from me because I've done that. And I'm like, no, signposted.
Yeah.
Like, signpost, like, this is the first strike. This is the second strike. The next time it comes off, so it's fully worded out. But you kind of have to, the thing is, you have to follow through with the punishment, otherwise the threat of the punishment is nulled. So, like, if you say, if you don't study or you don't do this, you're going to end up in summer school, and, you know, like, that summer school thing has to be there and has to kind of happen in order to reinforce what you said, otherwise you're pissing in the wind, you know what I mean? It's like, you kind of, it sucks, but it kind of, it's the way the world works. I totally just become like an old man now.
You get to the point
where you're like, this is how the world, like,
yeah,
like, I wish, like, I remember, I wish I'd spent more time, like, unpacking when my mom said that to me. This is how the world works, Duncan. I'm like, oh yeah, I'm sure it does. And I, like, never questioned, like, what do you mean when you say that? Oh, so things do have a consequence. Oh, right, tell me more. You know, I never did that. So by the time you learn as an adult, it's kind of like, I really wish. But you do. That's the thing. As a kid, you're told about it all the time. It's just, it's so far down on the list of things of interest.
Yeah.
That, you know, I don't know.
I tell the kid all the time, I'm like, here's the thing. When you get a job, you can either be the best at it and be an asshole, or you can be okay at it and be a really nice guy.
Mm-hmm.
And right now, you're not good at either of those things. Like, you're kind of a shithead. And also, not very good at anything. So I don't know where you think the money that you dream is coming to you is going to come from.
Yeah.
But being a you know, below average student who also has a bad attitude is really not the place to be. You know, it's like the Animal House thing of like, fat, drunk, and stupid is no way to go through life, son. You know?
Yeah.
But you're right. Like, the girl is very much like Winter, where she has her tablet and she likes playing Roblox. God
help us all. My daughter, that's my daughter's jam. That's what she does as well. So.
And so all you have to do is be like, hey, if you keep this up, you're going to lose internet, which means no Roblox. And we're going to take your tablet away. And she's like, I don't know what I did, but let me begin. First of all, I apologize unreservedly.
Here's the opening statement in my 10-part apology, right?
Yeah. Right,
you part can, one.
and like she'll grumble about it, but you can completely rein in the behavior that way.
Yeah.
The boy, on the other hand, has already lost all internet privileges. Hasn't had the internet in a long time. Lost his Xbox, which is a bummer for me because I want to play video games.
Mm-hmm.
And I use him as an excuse to do that. And with him not having the Xbox, I can't play as many.
You're not getting the Xbox. Nope.
You're right. Like, if you don't play Xbox, that means I can't play Xbox as much as I want. So get your shit together. So all of that is gone. The only thing he has access to is the TV. And even that is like sporadic.
Yeah.
So it's like, we can't take it. Like, you are the threat right now, aside from like losing like birthdays and Christmas and stuff like that. The other big one is like, you've got the biggest room in the house and we're about to put a lock on that thing and move you this little room where the cats poop and you can live among the cat feces like an animal. But that's also a problem because I'm like, when I move in, it's like, that's going to be my office.
Yeah.
I get the poop room.
Yeah.
Which kind of shows you where my status is. But right now the conversation is like, well, we're going to have to move him to the poop room.
Yeah.
Where he's just going to sleep on a mattress on the floor surrounded by litter boxes until he could behave at least for a couple of days in a row. It's insane. And like, I come from a background like where I was always the good kid.
Yeah.
You know, like I was good in school. I didn't like, it's not like I blindly, I didn't blindly, you know, accept authority, but I also knew well enough that like, you kind of go along to get along.
Yeah.
And so like, if you want to bitch about your teachers and be like rebel and all that, you just kind of do it in quiet out back and not
you don't have to agree with anything, but there's an easy road to get through things and there's a difficult road, and why spend all that time going through the difficult road when, you know, just putting a pleasantry on, keeping your thoughts to yourself sometimes and smiling can get you through that easy road.
I know the number of times I've told him like, you are the one making your life harder.
Yeah,
it's not it, like in his mind though, it's just like everybody's mean to me and wants me to be somebody that I'm not, and you're like, well, if this is the person you have decided to be, you can choose to be that person, but it makes life much more difficult for you. You can change like literally two things and your life is easy. Like it just drives me fucking crazy, man. He has every opportunity in the world up like, you are a young white man in America. Have you not gotten that through your head? And you were upper class, kid. You were like, you have everything, and you're, you know, just, I'd rather be in trouble all the time and not have shit. All right, well. You want to talk about some movies?
I've forgotten what it's like to talk movies with you. It's been that long since we did it.
I've got mine loaded up if you want me to go first, but if you
You kick us off and I'll
okay,
no doubt feed in.
Let me start off with my bad.
Oh, you got bad.
Well, because I don't want to linger on it, but I also want to at least address it, which is, it's not what you think it is.
All right, go for it.
So I want to talk about VHS 99.
Oh yeah. I don't think I'll be that far away from you on this. I think we'll see, but. Go for it.
Okay, so this is one I talked about on an episode of Found Footage Fool recently over on the Dark Parade, available on the podcast catcher of your choice.
Oh, look at that. Look at that.
But the problem, I think, with VHS 99 is there are it is stories that you would expect to be in VHS 99 for the most part.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like, you know, we've talked about a million times, every anthology kind of lives and dies by the quality of each segment.
Yep.
The first one of them, I'm like, this is a completely mediocre VHS 99 segment. The second one, I was like, this is, it's
got second some- one had a great setup, but the ending was like, see the idea, and I was thinking, the more I thought about this, the more I was like, that, why have we not had, this is a movie, the idea of like a sorority or whatever they're supposed to be, like pranking someone by burying them and then being chased off and that person physically dying and them having to deal with the consequences of that afterwards is a great concept for a horror movie. Yeah. It's like fucking perfect concept for a horror movie, and then they fuck it in the ass, bro, because it's a VHS segment, so we need a scary reveal of some sort of creature. And to me, and that's the dude that did a fucking 47 meters down.
Yeah. Johannes Perfisherman.
Johannes.
Yeah.
Klata Barat. A great setup, terrible ending.
I thought, I don't disagree with that. Although, in terms of it being a VHS segment, I'm like, okay, that was above average. You know, it's and honestly, the moment where the girl is trapped in the coffin and starts hearing the knocking on the coffin, I was like, that's really scary. That's a scary
It's creepy. Sound. And the effects of the, you know, the ghoul or whatever it's supposed to be, really well done.
Yeah.
Like, I liked that. I liked it. But like I say, like, to me, it had such a, like, it's almost like the reverse, the vanishing.
I mean,
which to me was like, that's a really, that is a really, and we've seen it done before, you know, you accidentally, like people accidentally kill someone at shallow graves, you know, you accidentally kill someone and how that affects your relationship and all the rest. But like, to me, the idea of it done through that prism was really interesting. Mm-hmm. And then it became like everything else on this really by the end. What did you think of the third one?
The Flying Lotus one? I thought it was terrible.
Yeah, I would agree.
And it's the one, you know, again, I said this on Dark Parade, but that was the one where halfway through it, I just stopped watching VHS 99.
Yeah.
Where I was like, the color palette is terrible. The camera work is terrible. I don't give a shit about anything that's going on here. It's just, you know, it's just bad filmmaking.
Yeah.
And I went back and I finished it. And I still, even at the end of it, I was like, this was garbage. This is
badly written. It's really, really, really badly written. Because I was thinking about it, it never really explains. Not that that's a thing for me, but it never, like the previous segment. Like, so the first segment, like in the 3 minutes it took to explain that story, I knew what the premise was. I knew what the setup was. The payoff happened. Seen it done before a million times, but there's a story there. The second one, there's a story there. The third one, there is no fucking story. There is no story about it.
I mean, I guess if you were writing the plot of it, it is young girl goes on weird child's game show.
Which, is, once again, the 90s was full of these weird child game show things, right? But like to me, they're like that. Ozzy, like, if you get through this, Ozzy will grant you a wish. And I was like, cool. But there's no explanation as to what Ozzy is or anything like that until the very end. And even then, it didn't make sense.
Yeah.
And none of it made sense. And it was a bit, it's overtly mean. And I've got an issue. I've got an issue. If this guy was a complete, if we'd seen like a clip of him, I don't know, like sweeping things under the carpet from the girl, like hurting her leg and all the rest, then I'm done with that. But like they literally torture the fuck out of this guy for what probably wasn't his fault. He's a host of a game show. He don't fucking control the game show.
And it's all pee and poop stuff.
Yeah,
you know, when they're torturing him. And I'm like, I don't find this interesting.
No.
You know, like, it's not offensive or shocking or whatever. Like, it's been done by better movies. And
100%,
like, if I want to see pee and poop stuff, I'll just go watch, you know, Sallow.
Yeah.
And if I want to be shocked by it, but this is just like, oh, isn't that gross? And it feels like Speaking of middle schoolers, it feels like something a middle schooler would write.
Yeah.
And you would be like, all right, I understand that you were not very well emotionally developed, and that's where this came from.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't think it ends very well. And then you've got the Medusa segment, which was like, okay, this feels like something that would be it follows that pattern like the first one of,
Yeah.
hey, some people run afoul of a thing that they shouldn't have been fucking around with in the first place.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, fine. The CGI is not terrific and all that, but it at least isn't overly long.
No,
And then the last segment I genuinely liked. I thought that
I'm
last
the same
segment,
as you, but
yeah,
that's the dead stream.
which was also very fun.
Which was also in 1 month that guy's put out two really good found footage things
Yeah.
on Shudder. And I'm like, yeah, like just keep giving him money. Like, please. Like, he clearly has a sense of humor. He can write horror comedy really, really, really well. And he understands the visual tool. He understands found footage better than any of the other directors on that. Because it made sense in a really fun kind of, and like that's the only time I can think of, because it, like they say, like VHS 99, it literally takes you to hell. And I'm like, oh cool, I can't, because how many times have I seen Jason goes to hell? How many times have I actually not seen hell in a movie? And I saw it in this one, I was like, that's a really like, I
Yeah.
can believe that if that was what it was. So
It
yeah,
was
I enjoyed that last segment.
really ambitious
Yeah.
in a way that like even Deadstream wasn't. Deadstream's very
Yeah.
contained and it works for that. And I enjoyed Deadstream quite a bit, but this was like it wasn't just the fuck around and find out philosophy of a lot of these segments. It was
Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
what if these people were there at the moment of a demon summoning, and
Yeah.
just by sheer bad luck,
Proximity, yeah.
yeah, end up in hell and are trying to figure out what to do. And it's
Yeah.
like that's a very good premise. And
Yeah.
having the girl actually from Deadstream,
Yes.
the one who played Chrissy in that.
Well, and the main guy as well. Well, the main guy, the actual dude that directed it is the main character in both. So
And having her, like I said this before too, but her playing this almost like Shakespearean Puck character
yeah.
who's like, what do you mean you don't want to eat human flesh?
Yeah.
And what are you even doing here? It was really funny and it was really
Yeah.
clever, and there's kind of a title tag or an end credits tag that
Yes.
pays that off in a way that's
Yeah,
kind of
yeah.
fun. It was like, so there's one segment that is slightly above average and one that's legitimately
But
good.
isn't that VHS though? Like, I was thinking about this. That's my ratio for pretty much every VHS that's ever been released. Is there's one segment I think is really, really, really good. Last year's one was the found footage right wing militia group that kidnaps a vampire.
That
I
was pretty
loved
fun.
that. I thought it was so funny.
I thought
Like,
the rat thing was funny too, the rat god
I
one, I
was all
thought.
right with a rat thing.
It was quick enough that I was like,
Yeah.
okay, this is fine.
But like when you get that, like that's what I'm saying. Like, I think all the VHSs for as long as I can remember have like one incredible segment, one that's above average, a pretty ropey Lincoln segment, and the rest is kind of like basic bitch found footage horror. And
Yeah, the
I
linking
but
was
it's a
just
formula. Yeah,
paving
the
there.
thing is, it's done well. It's the most watched original property on Shudder, and they're doing another one. And I'm like, well, like, listen, there's an audience there for it. It's just, I don't know why I keep going back to expecting something better than what I've got, because we're what, five movies in now, and they all are pretty much the same formula over and over and over again. And I feel like it's various shades of, I think this is well done. To like on one of them to other ones where I'm like, that this is like amateur hour. What are we fucking doing here? And that's kind of the way it is. And I don't know if I'm happy about it, but
You know, if maybe I should just be happy that like everyone contains a segment that's almost as good, if not as good, as that going to hell segment from 99, which is
yeah.
really good. It's really fun.
Yeah. Oh, 100%.
And so that's why I kind of wrestle with it, 'cause I'm like, it's real uneven. There's some stuff that's completely expected, and I just wish there were more of the like unexpected, we're gonna have fun with this premise in And like you said, for it being set in 99, the fact that there's not more Millennium stuff in it seems like a missed opportunity. That's an
obvious missed thing for me. Is I think Y2K's mentioned once.
Yeah, and it's in that segment. You know?
Yeah, and I'm like, why is this not being mentioned like all the way through? I mean, it does, like, there's certain things, there's a certain, even the, like, you're talking about the pee-poo thing, I'm thinking about that, if, like, if you were watching, like, early CKY videos back then and stuff like that, that was the majority of the humor in it, so I kind of get it to an extent, but I don't think it worked all that well overall. Also, it was just very, it was surprisingly mean. And yeah, that's not something that usually gets me, but every segment was, like, surprisingly mean. Yeah. Whereas in the past, I think there are segments where people have, like, either survived or something's kind of happened. Oh, we just got out there and no more. Like, this one, it was like, no, they all must die horribly. Like, everyone must die horribly in this.
Yeah,
so,
I mean, again, going back to the Rat God one from the previous installment, like, it ends with, you know, all hail, you know, rats.
Yeah, all hail.
Yeah,
well,
yeah, it's like
that to me. That's fine. That's well, that is fine that we can have that. I will counter yours with a movie that I dare say we're not going to spend any great degree of time talking about, because I'll just be honest with you, it was surprisingly fucking boring. But does have a director behind it who, like, did The Vigil, and I love The Vigil. But Firestarter is,
oh yeah,
like, just wake me up when the movie's done. Like, now I'm starting to realize why Episodes of Heroes was like 40 minutes. You know what I mean? Because that's basically what it is.
It tries and to it, turn Firestarter into kind of a superhero origin story.
100% does that. And in a world where that Brightburn movie's already done that, mm-hmm, and done that really well, you know, the idea of here's like a superhero, what would happen if the, you know, the people that gained superhero powers, or, you know, some entity from somewhere else that had superpowers on this planet just decided he was bad, you know, or just decided that he didn't want to follow your morality, or, you know, and he said, what would that play out like? But the idea of this one being anything other than, and, like, I don't understand. Like, here was the thing that kind of went over and over in my mind. I don't know why this property, because Firestarter, the original one, with is more known nowadays as the debut film of Drew Barrymore, or there or thereabouts. But it wasn't exactly, well, this is top five King. It's a relatively okay average movie then, based on a not great source material. The Firestarter story is not that. Not one of King's best, is surrounded by heavy hitters. And then we're going to do it now, and we're going to get a good director to do it, and we're going to get, like, a competent group of actors involved with it with good special effects, and it still turned out as painfully beige. I just don't know what the outcome... I don't... And I also thought to myself, I don't know who the market is, because even if it is superhero fans, there's not enough of that in the movie to merit someone that was really into superhero movies going to see it. There's not enough horror in it. Even I came out going like, is this even a horror movie? Like, I don't think it is. So ultimately what I was kind of left with was, I am unsure at any point in this movie who this is actually aimed at. Like, it just felt like a kind of almost a catch-all. We maybe get some people that are interested in this, maybe get some people that are interested in that. We'll shove Zac Efron in it because everyone loves a bit of Zac Efron, who's really good in it. Once again, yeah, he totally just continually reminds you he's a good actor. But the kid was not great. The ending was baffling. And like, just everything throughout it was just a whole lot of... You got Clarence fucking Bodiger in your movie. I love that guy, right? Like, can you fly, Bobby? He's in that, and he's in a blink and you miss him role that adds nothing to it at all. Why is he in that movie? It's just like a whole lot of that. There's a whole lot of why. Maybe spoke about it a little longer than I expected to. It wasn't even the worst one I saw on my 31 of October, but it was the one at the end of it that I was just like that. I've literally wasted my time here.
Yeah, it's not just a bad horror movie, it's just it's a real nothing of a movie.
It's a nothing of a movie. One of those ones that, you know, I know for a fact next year I will remember fuck all about it.
Now that, like, we've talked about Clarence Boddicker being in it, I'm just thinking of him going, Firestarter's leave.
You're like, just give me my fucking phone call. You know what I mean? So many great lines. Such a great villain. He's a fucking professor in this. I'm like, that's bad casting.
Also, why have your villain, or, you know, kind of that George C. Scott character from the original, makes this weird hero turn at the end that doesn't make any sense? I have no
clue what that is. It makes, you know, like you say, it makes, the ending left me visibly perplexed.
Yeah.
I was like, what are we doing there?
Yeah. It right, like, I understand the, like, you gotta burn it all day. Like, I'm unusually fond of both book and movie Firestarter, even for no good reasons. I understand that. I understand this is a me thing, not a quality of the movie. But there is something I find genuinely good about both in the book and the movie, where her father at the end of it is like, gotta burn it down, Charlie. Burn it all down. Don't ever let him do this again. And that's what she does, and it's like, fuck yes. Like, you know, and again, I think the effects of the original movie are kind of interesting. Those big fireballs blowing up buildings and stuff. It's like, this is pretty good
for the time. Yes. Yeah. Very good. Yeah.
And like hitting a dude and throwing him up in a tree and exploding and all that kind of stuff. It's like, this is what the fact that you didn't have that scene in this movie
is baffling.
Right. Yeah. Like, why don't you, there's no like, culminating a fire starting event in the movie Firestarter that makes you kind of sit up in your seat and either cheer or you're
it doesn't crescendo at all.
Yeah,
it just maintains a kind of meh piece all the way through it. And I find that well, that's what I'm saying. I don't know who it's aimed at. Like, if it's an action movie, there should be more action in it. If it's aimed at a superhero crowd, they're preconditioned for that action that you're not getting. If it's for the horror crowd, where's the horror?
I could not
get my head around it, except that maybe it's a very elaborate Ponzi scheme for financing like drug money from the cartel. Like, I couldn't work out why. And once again, it's another notch on the inevitable decline in quality of Blumhouse, who 4 years ago, I think, had four or five horror movies out that I was like, these are all genuinely fucking great original properties. And now we're in the remake factory, which we're about, you know, which we're in now. That's their world. And any interview with Jason Blum now is basically, you know, I'd love to get the rights to Nightmare on Elm Street. And I'm like, oh, goody. You know what? I would love you to, I don't know, make a Happy Death Day 3. Go and give that guy money to make that movie, as opposed to fucking sitting on. Like, it's not as if you can't afford to do it. You can totally afford to do it. I don't know. It's just it's a head scratcher, Bo. But yeah, to me, that was. And the thing is, I went in not expecting to like it because I'd heard the traffic, but I think I maybe disliked it more than a lot of people did. So,
yeah, I mean, we can vie for that crown. I thought it was real bad, and I'm somewhat of a defender. Like, I can't remember if it's Firestarter or Cujo, but it, whichever one of those is the one that Stephen King is like, I don't remember writing that shit. I was on blow. I was drinking a lot. I know the book came out, and I got paid for it, and they made a movie out of it.
Yeah,
that's how I know I wrote it. it came out of that period of
Stephen King. Yeah.
Where it, you know, people were paying him millions of dollars to write whatever was coming off the top of his coked up dome.
It's like that interview with John Saxon where he talks about making the weirdly titled Cannibal Apocalypse, which is like a Vietnam zombie, like, on the street crossover, like, veteran sort of movie. And he literally said, I was going through a messy divorce. I had, like, bills to pay. I moved to Italy for a couple of years, and I can't remember any movie I did. Like, I made about eight, and I remember none of them. Like, so, what are you going to do?
And I think that, I can't think of the director's name now, but the guy who did The Vigil, which was a terrific movie.
Great movie, And his segment in Cabinets of Curiosities was really good. So
I wonder if this wasn't edited behind him or reshot, or maybe it's just, you know, they threw a dump truck full of money and he was like, hey, I can make
that's,
this.
Listen, that was my thought. My thought was, I've obviously struggled and hustled to get where I have. I've got this movie that's got acclaim now. One of the biggest horror studios in the world is preparing to give me money to adapt a Stephen King property. I'm going to fucking do that. And then, yeah, you know what I mean? You can, he didn't write the script. As well directed, yeah, as just meh.
Yeah.
It's so, just not a good
movie. So, yeah. All right. Let's turn our attention to something good then.
Yes.
And Duncan, I am proud to report.
Oh.
That my good this week is the movie Weird, the Weird Al story.
Oh, I've yet to see it.
It is a delight. So I'm gonna say there are some spoilers here.
Ooh.
Because if you have any interest in seeing this, I'm gonna tell you to go ahead and see it, but I'm gonna spoil some stuff that is better if you experience it, not knowing. Because, all right, so the movie is smart enough to understand that an actual biopic of Weird Al Yankovic isn't that interesting, because by all accounts, he's a very nice man who has done very well for himself and been good to the people around him. And so the movie is instead a parody of biopics.
Ah, nice.
Which makes sense that a parody artist is given the parody treatment in a biopic. And so it starts off, as you would expect, with him as a young man who has a secret dream to make up different words for songs that already exist.
Mm-hmm.
And his parents coming down hard on him for that. In fact, there's a line his mother has where she says, like, we love you. We just don't want you to pursue your dreams or do the things that you love if these are the things that you love. And his father is also weirdly anti-accordion. And so when Thomas Lennon, as the door-to-door accordion salesman, shows up, his father beats the ever-living shit out of him on the floor. And so Weird Al leaves home to pursue his dreams of being an accordion player. Also, he gets taken home from a polka party by the police, who roust a polka party, which is a thing that I find very funny as well. They're like, sorry, Mr. and Mrs. Yankovic, we found your son at a polka party. What? You know, it's that kind of thing. And so he ends up pursuing his dreams and, you know, like, he's living with some roommates as he's playing the accordion, and they're like, well, don't you have a dream? And he's like, yeah, I always wanted to make up different words to a song that already exists. And they're like, well, why don't you do that? And he's like, what, right now? I don't even know if I can anymore. And they're like, all right, well, if you say so. And so there's this terrific sequence where he's like, hey, does anyone want me to make him a sandwich? And they're like, oh, yeah, yeah. Hey, I think you'll find in the fridge there's some bologna with my name on it. Mm-hmm. And he's like, what? And they're like, yeah, my bologna. And My Sharona is playing on the radio at the same time. And you just see this moment of him, like, the light going off and going on in his eyes as he's like, wait a second. My bologna. It's so goddamn funny. But then it takes this right turn. Like, after you see him achieve some success with My Bologna, also he is challenged at a party by Wolfman Jack to make up a parody on the spot. And also the bass player from Queen is there. And so he does another one, Rides the Bus. And at the end of it, Wolfman Jack, as played by Jack Black, by the way, which is quite funny, is like,
oh, nice.
That is the most beautiful thing I've ever seen in my life. And it's so funny. And anyway, after this, the hard drinking Weird Al years begin, where he's just drunk and terrible to everyone around him and ends up in this toxic relationship with Madonna, who is secretly using him to try to, dude, he gets thrown out of Scotty Brothers Records at the beginning of the movie, and comes back in after he has written Eat It.
Mm-hmm.
And hands him the tape, and there, and he's like, here it is, my completely original song, Eat It. And And so they signed him to this big record deal, and then Michael Jackson releases Beat It after that in the context of the movie. And he's like, this was my one chance to be an artist who, now everyone's going to think that Michael Jackson wrote this song first, and I just parodied it, which again sends him on another spiral. Also, there is a drug cartel storyline happening in the background where Pablo Escobar is obsessed with Weird Al and is trying to get him to come play at a birthday party.
Fucking hell.
Dude, it is pitch perfect as to what this movie ought to be. It is so silly. It ends in a way that presents... Like, the ending of the movie suggests that everything that Weird Al did after 1985 could not have happened. And it's just one of those things, man, where it's just... It is... It's so silly. It is knowingly silly. Daniel Radcliffe, much like Leslie Nielsen in the Naked Gun movies, just plays it like it's a drama.
Yeah.
Like it's an honest to goodness, like Oscar level biopic.
I think you mean Liam Neeson in the Naked Gun movies.
Ugh, whatever. Yeah. Liam Neeson is the Leslie Nielsen of our day, apparently.
Yeah.
Which means that eventually he will be in a remake of Day of the Animals, and that makes me happy.
Also means that we will get Repossessed.
Oh, yeah. Repossessed 2. Blumhouse will remake that one, no doubt.
Yeah, I've 100%. Has to happen. It's on my list. It's not officially out over here yet, but will at some point, I think, before the end of the year. Yeah. So
it is
tracking them there.
Like, crazily well-reviewed. You know, Variety. See,
nothing but glowing reviews.
Big outlets are like, this completely ridiculous, very silly movie is also, you know, like it is the right way to make a Weird Al movie in that none of it's real.
Yeah.
You know, like some of it is. It's weird because when I was watching it with my girlfriend, there's a scene where he records My Baloney in a bathroom at a public bathroom in a bus station. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, that actually happened. That's real. He really did that. Yeah. But it's also in a movie where he is like karate kicking drug dealers. And it's like, this is just nonsense, but there's a little bit of truth mixed in with it. And that's what makes it kind of wonderful.
This is like this shows the difference in our relationships with our respective partners. I'm currently doing the same. Well, that didn't happen. That did happen right now with the Dahmer TV show.
Yeah.
And I'm that. Well, no, that didn't happen. 100% didn't happen. Oh, but see that?
Yeah.
100% happened. In fact, they've actually reined back a little bit on how gross the thing it was. So I like that, Bo. I like that we're there to correct things. Well, yeah. Like, false narratives.
We did that with the Dahmer show already.
Yeah.
So,
I'm three episodes in. So,
in fairness to her, she fell asleep about halfway through the Weird Al movie. I don't think it's because she was uninterested. She was just like, I'm tired and I'm going to sleep. And I was like, I can't stop watching this because the moment where Weird Al in the film is talking to Dr. Demento, who is taking a bath in a gold jacuzzi.
Mm-hmm.
And Weird Al is like, hey, what is eating nachos that Dr. Demento has offered him, as played by Rainn Wilson, by the way, who does a great Dr. Demento.
Oh, nice.
And he's like, hey, why does this guacamole taste weird? And Dr. Demento says, oh, because it's chock full of LSD. And then he goes on a psychedelic spirit journey. It's like, all right, I'm in. This is utter silliness. And I could not be happier that this is what this means.
Nice. I can't wait to check it out. It should be out here before the end of the year.
It's 90 minutes where at the end of it, especially at the very end of it, you're going to be like, that was like heartwarming silliness.
Yeah.
You know, like it's like throwaway jokes. Like he keeps asking his father keeps telling him, like, you're going to end up working down at the factory with me, and him being like, well, what do you guys even make at the factory? And his father's like, you'll find out once you start working there. And it just becomes a running joke through the movie of like, you never know what this factory makes. It's little silly shit like that. It's very, very funny. So, Yeah, but if you have, even if you're not a Weird Al fan, it's a good parody of biopic. It reminds me a lot of Walk Hard. Level of like, we're going to take all of the beats of a biopic and just turn it to the illogical extreme.
So
give me your good now that I have waxed poetic about the beauties of the Weird Al biopic movie.
Yeah, so like over October I saw a ton of really, really, really good movies. So like my list this year was surprisingly good, which I think it like is doubling down on this year, has had actually some really great horror movies. Like surprisingly, I like, just even on a base level, the quality is better. I feel there might not be like the standout, well, this is the movie which like we will be talking about 10 years from now. There's been a few, but not to the level where I'm like there's no Get Outs this year, if you know what I mean. Even though Jordan Peele has had a movie out this year, and I've seen some that I will make a case for at the end of the year as being like high level. But the one thing I don't want to miss out is this year we got Guillermo del Toro's Cabinet of Curiosities on Netflix, which was for 4 nights. You got 2 episodes every single night where he managed to bring in like legit great directors and great cast and do something different. And some of it worked really, really, really well for me. Others, maybe not so much. I didn't dislike any of the episodes in there, but like at its top level, it gave me like a reminder that this guy is the guy to watch that no one's watching at the moment. And that is David Pryor, who directed The Empty Man, which I still think is a woefully underseen, I think we are going to come back to that movie, maybe not 10 years from now, but there are going to be pieces written about that, you know, is this the movie that we overlooked? And yes, you did overlook it. It's really, really, really good. He directed an episode called The Autopsy, which is the third episode in, and it is fucking brilliant. Like, absolutely fucking brilliant. Minimal cast. It has F. Murray Abraham as the main guy. He is brought in to do an autopsy after an event that's happened, which has like resulted in like an accident in a fucking mine, and they're trying to piece things back, and he comes in to essentially do an autopsy off the books for a cop that thinks there's more going on here. And it turns out there's a kind of Lovecraftian alien thing going on in the background, and it has, and I shit you not, some of the best horror you're gonna see this year in terms of design, acting, delivery, and ending. It's 56 minutes long, and it is a highlight reel of kind of why it's important from a Guillermo del Toro point of view that at the start of every single episode, he gives you a small introduction, and he tells you this episode is directed by, and he tells you who the director is right at the start. This is brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. I think it's fucking great. It's 56 minutes of I wish I'd seen this on a cinema screen. And it's not the one that I was like, that, like the Panos Cosmatos one is fucking great. It's very much a Panos Cosmatos one and doesn't necessarily fit in with anything else in the entire series. It kind of feels like, yeah, you just told him to go and do his thing and he was like that. We spoke about Robocop. He's got Robocop in it. Robocop is the cult leader in that. It's fucking great. And, you know, it's got some really, really, really good kind of twisty turny stories and some that are hyper stylized. The Autopsy is legit great. Just like across the board, brilliant. Amongst a series that, like I say, didn't do a bad episode. Some of them fit more my taste than others, but it's 5 stars. I think it's absolutely fucking awesome. And you don't need to watch it. Like, if you're listening out there in listener land, you don't even need to watch all the other episodes, but watch The Autopsy. It's fucking great.
I mean, absolutely. I've been
56 minutes. Yeah, and please send me a message when you have, because it's great. It's a great standalone, weird kind of, in some respect, it's kind of like a play on Invasion of the Body Snatchers, but done with a Lovecraft twist. And the creepy sound of the alien voice that you hear in it when the story starts to unfold of what it's actually doing, when it describes what it's doing and why it's doing it and what the setup is, genuine horror. It's fucking great, man. Why is not more people talking about this? It's the same with the Empty Man. I just don't understand why people are not like, it's like the kind of the, because Empty Man has that 25 minute cold open.
Yeah,
like that. And I remember seeing that going, this is fucking, oh, did he just, what? Well, it's this sort of thing. It's like, imagine that 25 minute cold open, but done as a kind of period piece. And when I say period piece, it's like shot in the 60s, I think it's 60s or 70s. And small town America with a Lovecraft alien sort of thing going on. And yeah. And F. Murray Abraham is fucking great in it. He's generally pretty good in a lot of stuff, but he plays it spot on. You're gonna love it. But more people need to watch that. Like, this is one of these things where when it finished, I was like, that Netflix, even if they don't do it every year, should be doing it every second year. This is event. This is like the sort of thing where I'm like, this is an event they should be doing. Just like Guillermo del Toro pick 8 directors that he thinks are doing something really, really, really good and sit down and craft stories and creature design. And there's an episode, in fact, 2 episodes are Lovecraft short stories, like adapted Lovecraft. And one of them, they were talking about, I saw like a behind the scenes thing. I think it's is it Pikmin's model or, mm-hmm. or yeah, like that. Well, they do that. It's got Crispin Glover in it. fucking.
Oh, sold.
What, I'm telling you, the cast and the directors are fucking great. Like, honestly, it's like you're watching, you're just like, oh, right. Like, and they do that. And at the reveal at the end of that, where you start to see where things are going with that story, Del Toro had basically said, like, we could do, well, he was told we could do these creature CGI, and he's like, no, puppets, yeah. Animatronic puppets. For all you see of them in it, it's less than 5 minutes. But they, like, they're a full fucking crack team of people building these creatures from fucking scratch like that. And I'm just like, that's what we need. Because it's Guillermo del Toro, and he's now got, he's worked his, he's eaten some shit, he's made some movies, which are not that great. He's done some movies that won Oscars, but he's now at that status now. He comes out like Alfred Hitchcock at the start of each episode, and I'm like, that's who he is now.
Mm-hmm.
He is our new Alfred Hitchcock. Like, just like Netflix, just keep giving them money and keep giving me stuff like that. Even if there's only one episode that I like, tell you right now, that one episode, that autopsy, is better than all the VHSs combined.
Oh, big words, Duncan.
Yeah, there we are.
I'm looking forward to watching that. In fact, I probably will watch that tonight. It reminded me, I wanted to recommend to you and the listeners a book.
Ooh.
And I look, I don't know, nobody likes to read.
I'm elected to lead, not to read.
Yeah, it's look, all those words put together, it's like a big puzzle. And you have to you have to want to get into it for that. But I'm in the midst of a book right now called A Black and Endless Sky.
Ooh, right.
Speaking of Lovecraftian, by a guy named Matthew Lyons. I'm about a third of the way through the book right now.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want to read something that is kind of modern day Lovecraftian horror, that mm-hmm. isn't like it doesn't wear it on its sleeve. It's not like fan fiction. It's just doing cosmic horror in a way that's really interesting and is good and violent and fast paced. A Black and Endless Sky by Matthew Lyons is terrific. So I mean, I don't know how it ends yet, but I'll it could be terrible.
You'll be eating some shit if it ends
right at the end of it's just like yeah. And by the way, we didn't mention it earlier, but all the characters are cats. I'm like, wait,
yeah,
that's not what I had in my head at all. But I've really enjoyed it so far, and like I like the writing style, and I like the fact that it's very, like, the book came out this year, so it's a very...
I'm always on the lookout for something, so... Yeah.
Black and Endless Sky's pretty good, and I will definitely watch that episode of Cabinet of Curiosities.
Yeah, like, that one, and, like I say, there's a handful of, like, you've got the director of A Girl Walks Home Alone at Night does an episode, and
her
episode is the one that follows up the autopsy, and it's like this kind of hyper... satirized, stylized kind of 1960s woman in the house kind of piece with infomercials and all the rest. It's really well done. Vincenzo
Natalie?
The cube.
Yeah.
He's the second episode. It's like 35 minutes long. It's based on a short story, and it's fucking great. Graveyard Rats, and you've got she does who chick that did the last one, did the Babadook. Jennifer Kent, she did the last episode. It's not great, but it's a good old fashioned slow haunting, like kind of haunted sort of story sort of thing. I didn't think it was like excellent, but the dude from The Walking Dead, the sheriff guy who's not been in it for years, he's fucking excellent in it. And you know, it's got the chick that played the mother in the Babadook plays the female character in it, and she's it. So it's got powerhouse performances. It just feels a bit predictable. Panos Cosmatos directs a completely fucking batshit hour of psychedelic drugs and weird synth music and weird lights, and
right.
It's like it ticks a ton of bait. Even if you don't necessarily think this is like the best horror short I've ever seen, I guarantee there's something in every single episode where you're like, that's really fucking cool. I'm glad they did that. And that's, that to me, that's all I want from an anthology. And the fact, like I say, the fact it came out and like our horror community was so busy still debating whether or not Halloween Ends is a good movie or not, I think is like a fucking, or if Terrifier 2 is worth your time. And there you have Netflix, a streaming channel putting out a fucking multi-million dollar budgeted project, which is all shorts of two every single night through the 25th through the 28th of October. And I was looking at a fucking vacuum of people spending any amount of time talking about it, which is weird. It's very, yeah, very, very, very strange. But I'm telling you, worth your time. Start with The Autopsy.
Will do. I also think that the Midnight Club, that kind of off-year Flanagan project,
disappeared.
Yeah, like nobody talked about that. I was like, this was good.
I still watch it, but like it's Flanagan. Like, well, to me, that should have traction. And
it's Bly Manor Flanagan, where he directs a couple of episodes and he co-writes some of the episodes, but he's not in on the whole thing, like Midnight Mass.
But
or
still, it's Mike Flanagan.
But it's still and it's a really interesting premise. And I know it's based on some books by Christopher Pike that I've never read, but but I like, you know, the where its head's at, and you know,
weird, man. That's what I'm saying. Like, October was dominated with the Halloween combo. Halloween versus Terrifier is literally all my timeline's been, and it still is, weeks on from both titles coming out.
That's crazy, because I couldn't care about either. I'm like, yeah, both
I mean, I'm happy that Terrifier did a lot of money. It's not a very good movie. It's bloody long. It's 2.5 hours.
Terrifier 2 is 2.5 hours long.
Terrifier 2 is 2.5 hours long.
What?
Yeah. It's okay. A 2.5 hour long movie. And I'm glad that some people are saying it's the best thing they've seen this year. And I'm genuinely glad it's made like 10 million. Because that, to me, I like it when scrappy movies have scrappy success.
Yeah.
But ain't nobody telling me that's a good movie. It got great effects, but the acting is on par with that first movie. And the story is on par with that first movie. And it's just, there's an extra hour of it. And Halloween Ends is a conversation for another time.
Yeah. I at the end of the day, I don't care enough about Halloween Ends to talk about it that much.
Halloween Ends exists in a world where you could literally remove Halloween kills completely, and it has no impact on that movie.
Yeah. It's almost like
zero impact.
It's almost like David Gordon Green and co. wanted to make a remake of Halloween or a direct sequel to Halloween that was really good, and then they did. And then somebody was like, well, this needs to be a trilogy, and they're like,
Evil Dies Tonight?
All right, that's your second movie. And also, there's a guy named Corey. That's part three. That's the piece I've made with it, is like, I really like that Halloween 2018. I think it's really good. And everything after that, I feel like was somebody's bad idea.
It kind of feels like, wait one second, like the Halloween franchise in.
Yeah, right. It reflects the Halloween franchise.
Yeah, which is what I can't understand the outrage about it, and what that is, literally a franchise which just delivers mediocre at best sequels.
Yeah. Like, I was initially, when I watched Halloween Ends, I was initially mad for about 10 minutes. And then I was like, okay, I'm done. Like, why am I getting upset about this? I don't really care about this franchise.
As soon as you unplug from that, it's a surprisingly dumb and enjoyable movie. Like, not a great movie. Didn't score high with me, but I was entertained right to the end.
I'll give you the dumb. I don't know that I enjoyed that much of it, but anyway.
Talk about something that I enjoyed this. This is like when I pitched this, this is why I pitched this. Like, just sort of an excuse for me to sit down and like talk about this movie with you is going to make me immensely happy, even if you only cracked a smile once during it. So
I enjoyed it more. All right, so obviously we're talking about our Return of the Pink Panther, or the Pink Panther Strikes Again, not Return. This is the movie that follows Return of the Pink Panther.
Yep.
Return of the Pink Panther was super successful, so Sellers and Blake Edwards team up again because there was just so much money going on. Like, it made
so
it
much money.
Yeah. And so the original cut of this thing, Duncan, was like 3 hours long.
I would watch it.
And the studio, was like, what in the fuck are you doing? This is a Pink Panther movie. And he was like, no, it's bigger than that. And they're like, no, it isn't.
Yeah.
And so it was cut down to, you know, the hour 40-ish minutes that it is.
Yeah, and some of it is worth saying, some of it as well is kind of almost Phantasm series put into a later installment, which happened post Sellers dying. So so some of the outtakes and scenes in here are used later on.
I think, Trail of the Pink Panther, I think, is where that gets used.
Yep. Yeah.
But we'll get to that in short order. But in this one, like, Sellers was really pissed off when he saw the final cut of the movie because so much had been cut out. And, you know,
you just got to think this was just like wall to wall skits.
Yeah. I mean, it is a gag based movie. And also, Sellers at this point, we're saying, like, you know, and we'll talk about it more in the next episode, but he is on his way to the grave at this point. Like,
His health was terrible.
His health was really bad, and there was a mental decline happening as well. Like, Blake Edwards said something to the effect of, like, you walk into any insane asylum, the first person you run into is Sellers.
Yeah.
Like, he ought to be locked up.
Yeah.
And so it was a set that was rife with conflict, but that's kind of been the story of Edwards and Sellers all through this, is that
since the beginning. Yeah. That's why you had that gap where they were like, that I ain't doing another movie with him.
Right. And then they do the party and that's really successful, and that and brings them back. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so what this culminates in is, like we were saying in the upfront, like 2.5 hours ago when we started this thing,
we've been off for a month.
Yeah. Everybody calm down. That it
no
it
one's really... saying anything. Well, I just calm down, listeners. Get off our fucking backs.
Yeah. Well, you're gonna get, it's been a while, so you get a beefier episode on the one bag. Like, next time the banter portion of the show will be like 30 seconds where we're like, you're looking well.
Yeah. Yeah, good day to you, sir. Yeah. Sunday. Yes, I agree.
Yes. Yes. And so the children, the wife. Good.
Yeah. And thus we shall start.
And thus begin. What cinema have you been watching that might be to your taste, Duncan? I don't know why we get suddenly formal.
I don't know. I found this movie agreeable. Yeah. Let's move on.
Duncan's agreeable movie of the week is... I found this one distasteful.
Ooh.
I saw Terrifier 2, and that was a real stinky poo. so dumb. Anyway... So this one, as we were saying in the upfront, is not really like, hey, something got stolen and, you know, the
Pink Panther. No, it's called a Pink Panther movie. There ain't no Pink Panther diamond in this one. There ain't no thief, really, to an extent. There is to an extent, but not really. That's not where the story's pitched.
Yeah. And it opens with my favorite character of the whole series, which is Dreyfus.
Oh, Herbert Lom. This is Herbert Lom's movie.
And
he's fucking incredible in this.
I just watched The Dead Zone for one of my 31 Days of Halloween. Was The Dead Zone?
Yeah.
And watching him in that, and
post this, it would be made after this. It's nuts.
Yeah. And it's like, I forgot how, like, what a good presence he is in that movie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the whole conversation of like, well, I would think about my duties as a physician and my oath to help people, and then I would go back and I would kill the son of a bitch, you know. And then
if he'd been harnessed in this, he'd be like, kill Hitler.
Yeah.
Kill.
And so it starts off with him talking to his psychiatrist.
Played by the same guy. We have continuity in this movie, like in the series.
Yeah. And based on my research, because I haven't seen the rest of these movies, but like what I read was like, this is the last time it even bothers with continuity and the rest of the series.
Yeah, this is the take it to like this is as expanded as it possibly gets in terms of nonsense. And then from there, it'll contract inwards, still be full of nonsense, but the ideas and concepts that it's going with, specifically with the Dreyfus character, go supernova. Like the next movie, the Dreyfus character is in that.
Oh, okay.
Like as if this never happened.
Gotcha.
Right. And they do it really, really kind of smart in that they don't acknowledge anything from this movie.
Right.
Which is fine. It's like a kind of fever dream.
It's a prequel.
It's you know, this is Halloween Kills, but it has no impact on the next movie at all. You can watch the next movie without watching this one. But yeah, Dreyfus starts off as from the last movie where he tried to once again kill Clouseau and got locked away and Clouseau got promoted. We are now taken off from essentially 3 years from that date.
Right. And so, and he's doing well, Dreyfus is. He's, you know, he's quit smoking. Great. He's got his shit together now. Like he's back in action.
He's about to be released, Bo.
Right. Like his psychiatrist is like, you know what? We're meeting this panel at 2 o'clock today. Yep. When we do that, I can't see any reason why we wouldn't recommend you for release. Clouseau.
Yeah.
And he's like,
he walks into the room and there's a dummy in the background wearing the Clouseau outfit.
It's a, he's got a hay boy. Another weirdo reference.
He's got he's talking to him and he's like, yeah, every day and every way I'm getting better. Yeah. And, you know, he's like, do this. But even he's kind of the keen intellect's back on. Even like when he's having that, or he's like, you know, there's nothing that would make me happier than sit here and watch you smoke yourself into an early grave and have these conversations where I can detect, you know, that you've had an argument with your wife like you did this morning because you're diddling. And he's like, oh, I keep forgetting that you used to be, you know, the chief inspector of the Surte. And he's like, and will be again when I get out. And they're like, well, you know, he's like, oh, the better man is going to be released and I'm cured and I can't wait to get back out there and regain my life. And everything's coming up Dreyfus.
Yeah. And up until Jean Clouseau shows up to lend a hand. So here's how it starts.
Yep.
He shows up. There's a crazy person like in a Native American headdress.
Yeah.
With a bow and arrow with like the suction cup arrows.
Yep.
And he sees this weirdo and then for no good reason decides he's going to hit a croquet ball.
Yeah. Like, so everything's paid off. This is what I love about this. Like everything he walks past here is then paid off.
Yeah.
Like if you see someone with a bow and arrow, that joke's going to be, you may have to wait for it. Is 100% going to pay off. And yeah, he sees a croquet, which I don't know, it's an English sport. I imagine it was popular. Well, it's a French sport. And really, if it's called croquet, it must be a French thing. So yeah, or it would be croquet, like in the UK. But yeah, he finds it. And of course, he grabs it. And yes, I remember it well. And he hits the ball, and the ball doesn't, like, hits it far too hard for a start. Uh-huh. It nails this thing, and it smacks poor Dreyfus in the back.
Ricochets off a tree. Yep. Hits him, who, by the way, was just peacefully feeding some ducks.
The most harmless, like in a tranquil, quiet slot. He's about to be released, Bo. Smacks him and puts him right in the water.
Right. And so, of course, Clouseau is trying to help him out of the water. Ends up finally dragging him out, is trying to resuscitate him. And giving him mouth to mouth, and
well, he's giving them a rub on the back at first, which two old women are walking past, and one of them gets really kind of upset by this. And he's like, "I will give you the keys of life."
Yeah.
He turns him over, starts breathing, and the woman walks over and fucking hits him in the back of the head and calls him a pervert. And then says, "Are a couple of filthy old men?"
Right, thinks they're pervert. Yeah,
yeah,
pivots.
Yep.
And so once, once Dreyfus realizes what has happened.
Yeah,
and that Clouseau is there has caused him probably to go into the water is definitely
most likely.
Yeah, because you know, and it, to his credit, he recognizes that just chaos follows this guy, and if something out of the ordinary happens, and Clouseau is there, it's because of Clouseau.
It's him. Yeah.
And Clouseau is like, "I'm here to speak on your behalf and make sure that you are returned to us."
Yeah.
And Dreyfus is like trying to keep it together. He's like, "I appreciate it. Thank you for coming. Yeah. It's not necessary.
Yeah.
You should please just go. Yeah, you should just leave." And they're sitting on a bench as they're having this discussion.
It's a great discussion as well, because he starts talking about like all the different people. I think he mentions Francois.
Yeah.
So like, yeah, he's like that. He's like, "Ah, yeah, he's like, you know what. Some people are, you know, meant to follow, others are to lead." And he's like, "Oh, you lead?" And he's like, "Yes, one day I may even like run for public office." He's like, like the laugh starts. Well, this, and he's sitting on the edge of the bench, and of course Clouseau stands up and the bench topples over and sends Dreyfus back into the water. Again.
Yep.
This is like the third time he's been in the water. And Clouseau goes to help him out, and just as he's got this thing, "Every day and everywhere I'm getting better," he's like, "And I'm going to get out of here, and I'm going to get my old job back." And then, and at that moment, Bo, suction arrow hits him right in the forehead.
Before that happens, though, is the rake, right?
Oh yeah, because
it's a sideshow Bob joke.
Yeah.
It's him getting out of this lake the second time, immediately stepping on the rake that smacks him in the head, which puts him back in the water. And this is the point where Dreyfus just starts giggling like a madman again.
Yeah.
and that's where he's like, "You know what? I'm going to do
Clouseau. I'm going to walk you to the gates. I'm going to kiss you adieu. I'm going to come back and I'm going to be released." And then the suction arrow hits him right in the forehead, and without missing a beat, he says,
"And then I will kill Clouseau."
Grabs him by the throat, and Clouseau's like, "Kill Clouseau! Kill!" It's fucking amazing.
So yeah, and he's chasing him back to the car, like gets tackled by orderlies who are carrying him back as Clouseau gets in his car. It is very sad that he has not been able to get his business together.
Was feeding ducks 5 minutes before, the calmest man in the world.
Was fine. And in that small, like, even with the psychiatrist, like, testing him and mentioning Clouseau and all that stuff, he's like,
because, all he's doing is shouting the word Clouseau like that. Yeah. He's not doing the series of, like anarchy like that will happen 5 minutes with Clouseau. Like, you can't test that. You can't test that in a fucking confined environment.
Right. Well, there is no simulacrum of Clouseau. It just, it's him or nothing.
And
so, you know, he's back in his murderous form while the psychiatrist like looks down from his office window and shakes his head. And then we get to the credits, which just to pay lip service to it, it's a lot of like Clouseau chasing the Pink Panther through a bunch of movies.
Yes.
Like Sound of Music and that kind of stuff. And it's fine. You know, it's kind of a neat credit sequence. But let's get back to what's important here, which is Herbert Baum.
Yeah, but this is the beauty of this movie, is like, instead of then setting up a story right after the credits where we've got a long clip or something like that, no. It's right into Lom has escaped.
Yes.
And he's going to kill Clouseau. this is his initial, "I am now out. I am going to kill him." And because this doesn't end up going the way that Lom wants, you then get the next phase of this movie. There's no that, like, regardless of what we say about this movie, there really is no fat on this movie at all. This is a lean, we do set piece. Well, this is the way this story, most of the time the story won't make much sense, but we're going to rattle through this right to the very end. And all that other stuff that we did before were relationships and, you know, like love interests or, you know, like another character that isn't Dreyfus or Clouseau ain't in this movie. Mm-hmm. Like, this is the movie, and it's the most streamlined version that you're going to get. The next movie is predominantly Clouseau again, but this is the antagonist. This is the protagonist. Turns out the protagonist makes everyone feel like he's the antagonist, but, like, we're going to do this. And you have Clouseau coming home with his groceries into his apartment building, and the bag's ripped at the bottom, and thinking, this is such a silly
trail
joke.
Of rice following
which
him.
So his neighbor opens the door and sees him, and he thinks the best way to play this off is to pretend that he's a tap dancer.
That's a little soft shoe, yeah. And also gets his, you know, like, pocket of his pants hung on the door.
It's rehashed jokes.
Yeah.
You've seen these jokes before, but we're just using them in a different context again. And they work. They work. Yeah.
And while this is going on, Dreyfus is in an apartment
below
where he is busted in, bound and gagged of the owners of this apartment.
Physically kidnapped the owners.
It has one of those, like, drills that you crank. And it is, you know, drilling holes.
Periscope?
Yeah. Like, drilling holes in Clouseau's floor.
Yeah.
So that he can poke this periscope up through it to, like, basically, we later learn he is going to blow him up.
Oh, yeah. He's got, yeah. Yeah.
But
this building has been blown up more times than we want to care in this series.
Dude, the insurance that this building must be paying as long as Clouseau is a tenant there.
There's also that feeling after you see the Cato scene that's about to come up. Like, his downstairs neighbors must just be like, oh no.
Yeah.
like I'm fucking constantly.
This is maybe my favorite of the Cato scene so far. It
he's
just goes
so
nuts.
Good.
it's because of all the tools at work. But anyway, so so he's poking the periscope up through there. And because Clouseau is putting groceries away and also kind of looking for Cato.
He's desperately trying to thank you.
Yeah. Through the course of this, Dreyfus gets an eyeful of ketchup.
Yeah.
Then some dishwater.
Clouseau thinks he's in a tiny washing machine.
Yeah.
She's full of water. He's like, ah, sneaky, holds fucking water all over his floor. Man.
And so Clouseau then finally, you know, puts on his robe, is about to lie down in bed. And
he stands on his finger.
Yeah.
That's my favorite. Like he's already had a couple of bad things happen to him, right? But he eventually cuts through just as Clouseau's changing clothes, and his periscope's up against his black sock.
Yeah.
So he assumes he's drilled into somewhere without light, so he puts his finger through. Meanwhile, Clouseau gets a phone call from the governor or whoever it is, basically phones him to tell him that Dreyfus has escaped and come after him.
Yeah.
And he stands on his fucking finger, and you see the club he's hanging on by. He's like, ah!
Right. There's another point where, like, Clouseau just runs into the periscope, which knocks Dreyfus off the table. You know, and again, it's as cartoony as it could possibly be.
Because whenever these things happen, it's a slow-mo effect of them going, oh!
In this, Dreyfus is just Wile E. Coyote.
100%. Yeah. It totally is. But you're right. Well, he gets his kimono on, he lies down on the bed, and instead of the camera panning under the bed, which is where you expect the camera will go, Bo.
Yeah. It goes up, and you see that Cato has cleverly hidden on top of the canopy of the bed and is now, like, cutting his way through to launch his attack. And which is what happens is, you know, the attack is on. Clouseau gets his nunchucks.
He gets nunchucks from a pair of socks in the cupboard.
Yes.
Cato gets a bow staff.
Uh-huh.
Which we then get a sped up clip of, like, Cato going whoo, 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 around his neck. And then we get a sped up clip of Peter Sellers with what can only be described as plastic nunchucks doing the whoo, 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 this. And then it slows down. Oh, Kato goes running towards him. Clouseau steps out the way, snaps the, like, actually physically snaps the handle of one of the nunchucks over the back of the head, sending Kato right into the TV with his bow stick, which is just the first of many props we're about to see here.
Yeah, so there are, once the nunchuck is broken and Clouseau realizes it because he tries to whip it around again, and it's just a chain. So he gets like a bamboo sword.
Yeah, a kendo stick. Yeah. So he actually has a physical kendo stick.
And yeah, well, there's this whole cabinet of nothing but just like, you know, martial arts weaponry. And they're just pulling from it at various times. Yeah. So they're both, they're attacking and then they're hiding and chasing each other around. And there's a pretty good bit where they're like backing towards one another and rotating around
Great timing. Yeah. Like it's really, really well done.
And then the phone rings.
Right. This is the commissioner phoning to let him know about Dreyfus. So.
And so.
Defend. Yeah. Defend is ringing.
Yeah. It basically, time out. We have to answer the phone. And so he has. Kato then checks all the doors and windows to make sure that they're locked.
He turns around first, and Clouseau smacks him in the back of the head with the kendo stick, answers the phone, Dreyfus's fingers trapped, he falls down, and then he's like, nah, the insane Dreyfus has escaped the asylum, and he's coming to kill me. Lock all the doors and all the rest, and I will try on my hunchback costume.
And it's like,
this is for such a silly joke. The payoff to this joke is long and it's silly.
Yes. So he puts on this outfit that includes like a fake nose and a wig and, you know, battered clothes. So when Kato comes in and sees him, he's like, who are you? What have you done with Inspector Clouseau? He's like, Kato, it is me.
Yeah.
But
it works much better with the hemp.
Yeah, hemp. And so he starts inflating this hump.
With helium for some reason. Right. Air would have been fine, but no, for the purposes of the gag, we're going to inflate with helium.
Right. And
doesn't switch off, though.
So Dreyfus then calls Clouseau to keep him in place so he knows where he is, and starts packing some plastique on the roof above him. Blow the shit out of Clouseau. But what he doesn't realize is that because this hump has been inflated with helium, Clouseau is now floating above the floor and starts going out
he's
the window.
He's pulling a Salem's lot.
Yeah. You know
I mean? he's outside the window.
Right, it's a real let me in, Danny. Where he floats out the window, releases the phone at a certain point.
Yeah.
Which... the receiver swings down, goes through the window, hits Dreyfus, which knocks him onto the plunger hooked up to the plastique, which sets off the bomb, which sets the shockwave, then sends Clouseau flying.
Past Notre Dame, right? So he actually physically flies past Notre Dame while the...
Yes.
While two nuns are looking up for it.
And then he does a thing where he's like, to get down, he pops the hump, which does like a whole balloon. as these nuns watch and, you know, sends him into the drink or whatever.
Yeah, he ends up in the river scene, and we then see him like all wet, and like the commissioner speaking to him on the phone, and he's like, thankfully there was enough air in the hemp to make it a floatable, like a flotation device.
Well, because he's signing this order, like, I'm sending this bank robber to prison, and also there is a mad bomber trying to kill me.
Yeah, so he's about to send one of France's most notorious like bank robbers to prison, which you would think is a tangential thing, because we then have his breakout essentially.
Yeah, which is just him going to the bathroom, climbing on top of the train that he's on to take him to the prison, and a helicopter comes by with a ladder.
Yeah, rescue him. Flown by Dreyfus,
yeah,
like whose eyes doing the twitchy thing, but he's helping this guy escape, and then we get the montage of him basically saying, "Listen, that I have a here are the steps that we're going to do here right now in my organization. I want this list of the worlds. It's like basically like Demolition Man. I want this list of hardened criminals." And he's like, "Well, we're going to have to break them out of prison." He's like, "Yeah, yeah." He's like, "But I bet you're thinking, how would we do this?" And he's like, "Well, I'm willing to bet you 20 million francs that we're going to be able to do it." And he's like, "Well, where are you going to get 20 million francs?" He's like, "Aha, that is phase three of the plan." And this is done super quick. This is like a quick cut of they get 20 million and here they break out all these criminals. And Dreyfus essentially sets up his criminal organization, which then kidnap a scientist and his daughter. And that's like all done within a 2-3 minute window. Like of quick things that sets up the next phase in the movie.
Yeah, and like Clouseau is briefed on this robbery,
yeah,
and then begins to investigate the home of this professor and and daughter.
This again, is fucking just amazing. Another
set piece bit of him.
It's all set piece bits, and it's all stuff we've done before, but we're doing it like we're building on the jokes. So everything right. he does in this house, he's kind of already done before in other movies, but we're building on it. His interactions in this scene are fucking amazing. Like he's this is pinnacle Clouseau for just like being shit at his job. Like absolutely 100%. Everything he does is a mistake, but somehow the mistakes always end up like saving the day. But he arrives and he's introduced to Jarvis the butler, who he's then like he's like, and where were you? And he's like, "I was in my room alone at night." He's like, "Taking notes on the butler." And then he's like, "I want you to take me around the house." So the butler takes him upstairs, and about halfway up the stairs, he's like, "I think we should start with the upstairs." And he's like, "We're going upstairs." And he's like, "And now." So he walks along, like there are a couple of really quick jokes here that are just fucking amazing. So he's walking along this wooden paneled wall and he starts knocking it. It's like a thick thing. And he eventually gets to a bit where he knocks it, Sims Hollow. And he's like, to Jarvis, he's like, "This sounds like a door." And he's like, "That's because it is a door." And he's like, "Oh." And he's like, "And it's unlocked." And he's like, "And now." And he pushes it open and it's a black room. It's like no lights on. He walks in and you hear him switch something and you hear a... And this is a fucking... This whole scene here kills me every time I see it, because you see him like flick his lighter on and he appears to be walking, like answer a question. And then the light gets switched on. He's on a treadmill. Because he's in the gymnasium.
Right, upstairs gymnasium room, right?
He says to Jarvis, what light did you switch to turn the lights on? He's like, "The light switch." He's like, "It did not work for me when I tried this." And then he turns the thing off, and it might seem like these are wall-to-wall gags. He walks past the heavy back. He's like, "This must be the upstairs gymnasium." And he's swinging it on that, and then he goes to fucking punches the back, clearly hurts himself, goes,
"Yeah."
And breaks walks his across.
Wrist, yeah.
Yeah, he walks along to the parallel bars. He's like, "The parallel bars. You know, I used to do these in the academy. They used to call me the Pavlova of the parallels."
Right.
Somebody's like, "It is all coming back to me. Yes, I remember." And he tries to dismount, but there's a set of stairs beside them, which he then tumbles down. Rolls
dismounts
down
right
down into that. Fucking hilarious. Stands up, everyone's assembled in the room like it's the end of a Columbo movie. Everyone's assembled in the room, which he's like, yes, everyone is here. Stands on a woman's foot, who lets out a yelp. He karate chops a fucking like a set of armor. It goes everywhere, and he's like I can see, or some of the lines, I can see why the knight who wore this suit of armor died really easy or something. And as he's trying to help the guy put in, he puts on the hand containing the mace attached to it. So he now has a suit of armor glove hand on.
With a flail.
Full on fucking chain and flail at the end, which he can't get off. And you see him doing the old, will not fucking come off. And now begins the interrogation, which once again is fucking amazing.
Yeah, and it's like the thing that makes this good and funny is that it's just right on top. Like everything we're saying happens right on top of one another.
Yeah, it's so, gag.
Right. It doesn't give you that kind of space between them that a lot of the other movies do. And it's like, oh, this is what the pace of this should be.
It should always be this way. It should always be like set piece to set piece, and it should be him buffooning his way through all of it.
Yeah.
And sometimes we might take a little bit longer to get to the buffooning part, but as soon as that happens, the jokes need to go bang, 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 bang.
And so,
we can't, like you say, no space in between them, because the space almost devalues the joke.
Yeah.
If you know what I mean? Because you get that time where you're like, oh, right, because we have to build back up. We've had that whole set. We know something bad's going to happen, Bo. We're just waiting for it to happen. And then they all happen back to back. That's kind of what makes it hilarious. And we get another build up to a series of jokes in this section here.
Yeah. So he like swings his hand at one point, swinging the flail to knock out the beekeeper. Why is he wearing the mask?
What's your name? He said, like, he's asking his name, and what is your name? And he hits him in the face. Because he's got the little the gardener who keeps talking. There's a bit where, and it's such a silly joke when he's like that. Well, you said there's been a murder. And he's like, who said there's a murder? And he's like, who are you? And he's like, my name is whatever, the gardener. Is like, yes. And then he goes to turn it, like, he goes to say something else, and then he says the word murder, and the one of the cook or something says something, and he turns around to speak to her, and then the guy goes, well, it's because, and he goes, it's such a fucking stupid joke. Well, you said that. Like, I know what I said.
Then there's a bee loose also, and while
he's the beekeeper, Mr. Stutter Stacker or whatever.
Stutter Tutter.
He keeps calling them different names.
And while he's trying to get rid of this bee, he ends up just destroying a piano.
Antique piano, which the housekeeper then gets upset about. And he's like that. He's like, he tries to play it off. He's like, I can tell you're the housekeeper. And he's like, why? He's like, because you're getting overly worked up about, you know, a little bit of damage to the piano. And she's like, you've ruined it. And he's like, but nothing can compare to the value of the kidnapper who has kidnapped, like twists it.
Right.
Like, totally twists it. But meanwhile, what we've forgotten to say is this is in England. So he's physically flown to London, and he's at the behest of Scotland Yard, who are babysitting him. The main guy isn't there, played by Leonard Rotissier, who was a very famous comedian at the time, played in a lot of kind of sitcoms in the UK, very famous for that. But his lackeys are basically having to entertain this guy, who he's been described as, he's Panis's hotshot detective, Clouseau. And once again, they're finding out that this guy's an absolute moron. He's standing in front of the fire, right? Like, let's recap what we know. At some point, the kidnappers came in and kidnapped. And he's standing there, the balls starting to heat up in the fire, which is the second point. They did kidnap the professor and his daughter. And the third point is, my hand is on fire. And it's like, he's like, try to get this thing off his hand. So to cool his hand, and he puts it in a vase, which then traps his hand again.
Of course.
Just as Quinlan, the head guy, comes in from the police, and he's like, so this must be Clouseau. And he goes to salute him, smacks himself on the head with the vase, knocks backwards, hits a shotgun, which falls down and fires a lot of buckshot into Quinlan's ass.
Then
we do a jump cut to him very painfully getting all the buckshot out of his ass.
Right, and saying essentially, hey, this guy's an idiot. We all agree on that. But
can we all agree on one thing? He's an idiot here.
But we have, our tensions are a little strained with France right now.
Yeah.
So we can't tell them that their chief inspector is an idiot.
Yeah.
So we're just going to have to live with this, and basically, like you said, just kind of guide him to the answer if need be.
Yeah. He's like, where is he? And he's like, well, he's still checking out some of the people from the house. So he follows Jarvis to a nightclub to find that Jarvis is a transvestite in drag doing a drag show and is a singer. And he's up there going,
it's a real Purple Onion kind of situation. And this one, I think it's called the Queen of Hearts. Dance club, and he ends up dancing after the drag show. He ends up dancing with this butler, who tells him, like, I think the kidnappers are here.
We see some heavies coming into the room as well.
Yeah,
and then because it's a drag show, like, all these guys can fight. So we then get a kind of a bar fight in this scene where everyone just starts punching shit at each other, you know, like a proper brawl scene. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, in this whole thing here, we've had the Clouseau get shot on by a bird joke. Like we would get like there's a series of Clouseau based jokes that you've seen before in other movies done back to back in here. Kind of once again, kind of starter shot, like very, very quick paced. But essentially, Clouseau was arrested. He's put on the front pages of being escorted out of this, you know, drag club. And we cut back to Quinlan basically saying, I mean, what we're doing, these inspectors are like, that you need phone France. And he's like, I mean, what's the worst that could happen? And then they're like, and he's like, oh, okay, I'll phone France. Meanwhile,
mm-hmm.
Dreyfus has kidnapped this professor guy, and is not only that, but bought a German castle.
Yes. And
can play the organ like the Phantom.
Dude, it's a total reference to the 62 Phantom of the Opera, yep, where he played
100%.
You know, Eric the Phantom of the Opera.
Yep, love it.
And so this is where we get sort of the villain speech, where he's, yeah, like, you know, telling the professor, like, I'm fascinated by your work on space-time. Mm-hmm. And what we're going to do is build a doomsday machine and conquer the world.
Like, we're going to use sharks with lasers attached to their foreheads.
Totally. And and so the professor is like, there's no way. I refuse to help you. And he's like, so take his daughter to the schoolroom. And so they take this, like, you know, teenage girl into this room that has like a school desk and a blackboard. Yep. And Dreyfus goes in there, puts on a Freddy Krueger glove, and just runs it down the blackboard. And while she screams, no, no, stop. And the professor hears this from outside. And it's like, fine, fine, you monster. I'll help you. It's very silly. And so then we get our first look at the president of the United States.
Yeah, you can see that this is not a film made by Americans.
Yeah, it's
like the British have a particular view on the Americans.
Well, and
also, maybe unfair, but at the same time, kind of just.
It's the president, and it's Gerald Ford. Like that is, yeah, who they are trying to.
Yeah, because the guy that's there's a kind of parody on Kissinger here.
Absolutely, there is. Yeah, yeah. And Ford was like, even by American standards, was a bit of a buffoon. and so that's how he's presented. Like, because when they cut to him, it's him and all of his advisors, including this Kissinger stand-in,
yeah,
just watching a football game in the Oval Office.
Mm-hmm.
And then Herbert Lom hijacks the airwaves and is like, hey, I've got this doomsday weapon, and yeah, I will use it on a major city. But you can avoid this by bringing me Jacques Clouseau.
Yeah. What's the price of one Clouseau against, you know, the annihilation of an entire city? I mean, it's, yeah, a small price to pay. And they cut off, and the Americans kind of shrug it as, because he basically says, if I don't get Clouseau, the UN building in New York is just not going to be there anymore.
Right.
And they're like, oh, really? Like, he cuts off like that, like this. And then you get the transcript of them in England saying, yeah, like Dreyfus. Like, wait to hear this. This guy, Dreyfus, appeared on the TV. He was the guy before Clouseau, and he is certifiably insane and escaped from the insane asylum. And you've got Quinlan got that. Are they all mad? Like, are all these friends? Like, this guy is mad. Like, and he's like, yeah, and he's going to, well, this is just complete nonsense. And then they remember Operation, I'm going to call it Paperclip. It's not called Paperclip, mm-hmm, but it's Operation Paperclip. And they're like, oh, like, so we should take this serious because the guy who worked for the British government has been kidnapped, and he has developed the doomsday weapon that we may see here.
Yeah. So against this backdrop, Clouseau now returns to the Queen of Hearts Club.
Yeah.
To talk to Jarvis more, but he finds him backstage dying.
Mm.
And he looks like he's trying to say something, and you know, Clouseau puts his ear close to him, and the guy just kisses him on the cheek and then dies.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so Clouseau leaves there and goes to meet with Scotland Yard.
Yep.
And says, I'm going to Munich to find Dreyfus.
Yeah, because he found a flyer or something, a clue which said Oktoberfest on it. So he's decided he's going to go to Oktoberfest in Munich, because he thinks that might be where the next clue to get to Dreyfus is. Scotland Yard can't wait to get rid of him.
Right, yeah, fine, go to Munich. Whatever it takes to get rid of you, by all means, do it.
Please go. And then in the interim, we have the deadline appears for the UN building.
Uh-huh.
And of course, Dreyfus, like, enacts upon it. Like, he removes the building and basically says, you have 7 days. Like, it becomes a ring. You have 7 days to, like, dispatch Clouseau. You have to kill Clouseau in 7 days. And this is to the world. And if you don't, I will remove a major city from the map.
Yeah, and basically says, like, I know you all have assassins.
Yeah.
You need to send them to kill Clouseau, and once that's done, we're good.
Which is, like, what basically happens.
Yeah.
I think it turns out at the end of the 26 countries, originally it's 12, but 26 countries send their top assassins to Munich to kill him. So then it morphs into that movie, Smoking Aces. Which, like, every movie's just ripped off this movie, right? That's what we can establish. After this, every movie ripped. So 26 assassins descend on here. And then we are going to get a montage clip. But what I love about this is there's a scene with Dreyfus sitting there, like, yeah, there's, like, these 12 assassins have probably been sitting there. It's like, they don't stand a chance. They're like, listen, you've got some assassins in here, boss. Some of the best hitmen in the world are working your organization. Why can't you send us? And you're like, you wouldn't stand a chance. They're like, he can't be that good. And he's like, oh no, he's not that good. He's that bad.
Yeah.
It's like, he makes his doomsday device look like a water pistol. I don't know.
And that, I think, is the thing I like most about Dreyfus's character.
Yeah.
Is that he's like, he's not good at what he does.
Yeah.
Like, he sees Clouseau for what Clouseau is.
Yeah.
Which is, he is just such a moron.
Yeah.
Such a bleeding idiot that he can't. Not
he's anarchy.
Yeah.
He's anarchy. You cannot predict what he'll do. So there's no point in going in with a plan, because if you go in with a plan, it just won't work.
Right. And so why not basically, you know, outsource the murder of Clouseau to all the countries of the world? And there's a great scene where back in the Oval Office, like, Kissinger is like, you know, all of these other countries have done it. Why don't we send someone too?
Yeah.
And at least get the credit for it.
Yeah, and he's like that. When they're talking about it as well, as like, you know, like 26 of the world's assassins are descended on Munich. He's like, it's going to be a bloodbath. Like, it's like, because they think all these assassins are going to kill innocent people, you know, in the crossfire. They're all going to learn very, very quickly. Although I will say this, the killers in this one are, like, once again, this is a movie made by a Brit, starring a Brit, and as a result, our view on what other countries' assassins would look like are just basically the most stereotypical. Yeah, this is what someone from Germany looks like.
Oh,
this is
sure. What
someone from Holland looks like.
But even before the Oktoberfest, which we'll get to in just a second, because that's kind of the big, the big set piece. But there's somebody that tries to kill him ahead of it, by stabbing him. When he's getting into a taxi, and he turns around,
he goes to stab him, and he turns around and he stabs his briefcase, and the knife goes through the briefcase.
A briefcase he's found in the back of the taxi.
It's not even his briefcase. Yeah. And then the guy comes to get the briefcase off him, turns around, and as the guy with the knife is wrestling, he stabs himself.
Yeah. So already one assassin has been killed by the sheer knuckleheadery of Clouseau. And so then we get to Oktoberfest, where there's a dude with a shoe knife.
Yep. There's a large woman in drag who has blades in her breasts.
Yeah. But the assassins are kind of taking each other out.
Yeah.
Because everybody wants the credit for the kill.
Yeah.
So some of it isn't just Clouseau being an idiot. Some of it is the assassins killing other assassins.
Actually physically killing other assassins. And Clouseau's benefiting from all of it.
Right. But some of it is just him being an idiot. Like, there's the one with the little guy who's you know, coming after him, and just because of Clouseau bending over at just the right time, like, he gets a blow dart that kills him. And
yep.
you know,
the woman with the woman with the breast dagger, she goes to get him and he's holding a pretzel. turns around, she's got a pretzel stuck to her tits. But ultimately, the main guy, the thief guy from that was broken out at the beginning, he decides to dress as Clouseau.
Yes. So this is taking place back at Clouseau's hotel.
Yeah.
And, all right. So there's the Egyptian assassin played by Omar Sharif.
Yes, that's right.
Then there's the Russian assassin who is like a Leslie Ann Down, like a beautiful woman.
Plays Olga, the Bond.
Yeah.
Woman. If this was a Bond movie, that's who she would play.
Yeah. And the idea is she is going to seduce him and kill him.
Yeah.
And so Omar Sharif tracks the assassin who has dressed like Clouseau to his hotel room.
Yep.
Kills him.
Yeah.
Kills that assassin and thinks he's killed Clouseau and sees Olga in bed and is like, well, I'm here.
Yeah.
And so he slips into bed with her, rocks her world apparently.
Like hardcore rocks the world, because she's right after this, she's about to, this dickin was so good that she's prepared to turn her back on the Reds.
Yeah. has changed her moral philosophy. The sex was so good. And so,
but she thinks it's Clouseau.
right. But he, like Omar Sharif, slips out having just killed Clouseau, in his mind, killed Clouseau, bedded this woman, and now he's taken off.
He's having the best night ever.
Right. And so then Clouseau comes back in and she's like, oh my God, this has changed my entire life. It was
she basically says to him that the reason I was the perfect assassin was I could sleep with men, but I could never fall in love with them. But I have fallen in love with you. And would you be prepared to fall in love with a former Soviet assassin defector? And he's sitting there in these pajamas, kind of going, but she gives him the next detail essentially, which is, oh, by the way, this castle was bought by ostensibly Dreyfus.
There's a tattoo on the hand of the assassin that they find dressed up like Clouseau.
Yeah. Well, that's like, the guy, that's the thief that was broken out from the train at the beginning. And she's like, oh, that emblem is, you know, the emblem of whatever this castle, which was bought recently. And Clouseau's like, And now we're moving to the last big set piece of the movie.
Right. And so Dreyfus is told Clouseau is dead.
Yeah. And he's like, but also finds that he's got a cavity.
Right. So so Clouseau first tries to get a room. What did you say?
I think this guy that plays the hello, is your want is Zimmer? The little German landlord guy is Graham Starks, I think, who will appear in the next movie as Balls, the guy who supplies him all his costumes, and was in previous ones as different characters. So he's the same character actor that just plays in different roles in each of these movies as we go along. So he's heavily done in makeup. And he's like, yeah, I got that written. And essentially, Dreyfus phones down for the local dentist who's staying at this small chalet area, but he's not there. The guy takes the call. Clouseau overhears. Clouseau is like, that I need to get into his room. So Clouseau then goes up in his disguise as the dentist, which is fucking amazing, because you basically get the white. This is the Wile E. Coyote sequence of I need to get into a building.
Yeah. He tries originally to get in and falls into the lake, and then tries to scale and then falls into the lake again, and then comes back as the dentist.
Yeah.
And he looks like Albert Einstein.
He does. he's doing his worst Albert Einstein impression as well.
And which is kind of a neat trick of Sellers doing this bad French impression and doing a bad German impression
it's so good, because this is the genius of the actor, because he's in that fake German through French accent until he starts taking the huffing gas, and then it slips between the two, and it's really, really, really well done. I can't stress how he's, for all his flaws, the guy is fucking talented. Like, his comic timing is ridiculous, but essentially gets escorted in. And he's like, let me see the tooth. And he's like, that, the tooth, like all the rest. And he's working through, he's wearing these bottle, these kind of bottle bottom glasses, some really thick glasses that he can't see. So he's taking the glasses off and he comes across the, essentially the laughing gas, which he then, he's like, he starts giggling, gives it to Dreyfus. Dreyfus starts giggling. Dreyfus, like, the two of them in this scene are fucking amazing because they're both giggling at each other. And the henchman comes walking in to tell him that Clouseau's still alive. And Clouseau's got, like, he's like, hey! Like, trying to pull it in with pliers. And like,
with his, the makeup beginning to melt off of his face.
Yeah, Dreyfus thinks he's fucking high because he's like that. He's like, I don't know what you've given me, but your face looks like it's like melting. And he's like, oh, right. So Clouseau goes down, moves it, and comes up with a nose, which is pointing up the way. And he's like, how about this? And he's like, it's repulsive. And then the guy comes across and says, Clouseau's still alive. And he's like, Clouseau's still alive. And he's like, wait one second. He's pulled out the wrong tooth. He's pulled out the wrong tooth. There's only, and he's still giggling maniacally. He's like, there's only one man that would pull out the wrong tooth. And that is Clouseau. He is Clouseau. Kill him.
Yeah. and also, while they're chasing Clouseau, he's going to use the machine to blow up a city.
Yeah, he's still going to do it. He's openly said that to the, because he says earlier on to the professor, he's like that. He's like, I may keep you around even though Clouseau's dead. He's like, and he's like, but you're never going to let us go. And he's like, you're just going to keep us around and as part of your Eagle organization. He's like, ah, well, the thought did cross my mind. Because Dreyfus at this point, he's full psycho. Yeah. You know what I mean? He is the textbook psychopathic villain. Very, very, very clever. But, you know, his one weakness is he's insane.
I want you to teach me how to use the machine or I'm going to keep you forever is kind of the deal. Yeah.
That's the deal. So Clouseau hides in a suit of hides in a suit of armor, manages to get out the castle, and then sits on what he thinks is a seat, but for whatever reason, there's a medieval catapult.
Right. Well, it's a castle, Duncan. You got catapults laying around, and
a goat eats through the thing. Meanwhile, he's telling them to turn the fucking power up full on the cannon. And then Clouseau gets catapulted on top of the cannon, which swings around, and then the Doomsday Ray essentially hits Dreyfus in the leg and the castle.
Yeah. And so we didn't really say this before, but like when this beam hits like the UN building, it just erases it.
Yeah, like a line at a time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Almost like the reverse of one of those old printers you used to get where it used to draw everything. But I suppose that's how printers still work, to be fair.
It's like when Jeff Bridges gets hit by the computer beam in Tron and digitized. It takes him a piece at a time. It's kind of that.
Tron ripped off this movie as well. Just keep adding the list, Bo.
Rosetta Stone of modern cinema is the Pink Panther Strikes Again. But so, yeah, so Dreyfus gets hit, runs off as his leg starts to disappear.
Yeah.
The machine is like blowing up and exploding. Everybody runs. Clouseau tries to run out also, but of course falls into the water because there is water and a Clouseau.
So it has to happen every movie.
Right. And
he will be in water again before this movie is over.
Yeah, absolutely. And so our last shot of Dreyfus is him playing the organ again as he slowly disappears with his eye twitching.
Yeah, his eye's the last thing that you see before it disappears completely and the castle vanishes from sight.
Yes, and so Clouseau bumbles his way through, you know, saving the city.
Yeah.
He goes home, finds Leslie Ann Downe has turned his apartment into one big fuck room.
Oh, it's like with the bed that's in the wall, which she hits, and then it comes down slowly with the disco ball.
Bubbles, this song by Tom Jones called Come To Me is playing.
Oh, dude, this scene is, like, this once again is the testament to how fucking funny Peter Sellers is, because she's in bed and she's like, when you take over his clothes, so first he starts like taking off the jacket all seductively, folds it for no reason, then throws it away.
Yeah.
And then he tries to take his shirt off, and this is where the can't get his tie off, so it goes over his head like Rambo. Can't get his shirt off because the cuffs are trapped, so he's fucking desperately trying to but he's trying to still make it look seductive, so he keeps turning around going fucking this. Like, eventually gets off into his pants, still wearing socks and shoes, but okay. And like snuggles underneath the cover. Now, if you're me and Bo by this point, you know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Because it's happened at the end of every Clouseau movie.
Yeah.
Gonna happen here, but he's getting in. He starts singing it, but the bed's so big that, and they're under the covers, that he starts going the wrong way and can't find her. So the joke's being really dragged out. Then Kato like sneaks under the bed. So now you have three lumps under the bed moving around, and then all of a sudden you hear "Sam!" like this, and "No, Kato, my little friend." They start fighting on top of the bed. The bed bounces. It goes up and closes. And then we get the slow motion shot from the other side of the wall as they are physically thrown through brickwork and into the water. Cut to Pink Panther credits. Oh, that's the end of the movie. You fucking loved it. Because if this is laughs per, what was it, laughs per hour?
Laughs per hour.
This one must be stacked.
So I would say this is a solid 4 to 5 laughs per hour.
But let me say this.
That, yes, I didn't laugh out loud consistently watching this movie.
Yeah.
But it was constantly like, oh, okay, all right, I see where this is. Like, it was really, maybe faint praise, but it was really amusing in a way that, like, it's always going on. There's always something happening on screen. And yes. I found it to be way more entertaining. I probably found A Shot in the Dark to be funnier.
Oh, really?
Because I just like the construction of that movie a little bit I think. But I found this to be a more entertaining watch overall because it is a much more modern feeling movie or a modern feeling comedy.
Yeah.
Which is we are not trying to marry this robbery story with a comedy like the
well
whole
this is
thing
what
is
comedies are now if you go and see a comedy in the theaters now, it's like set piece, and the jokes have to be thick and fast because that's how a comedy is now gauged, as opposed to like the kind of farcical stuff that you got back in the 60s. Is like we've moved on from that. This is like, you imagine if this movie was 3 hours long, how much of the story is actually being kind of, because we do meet big, I said it before, we get a supercuts of Dreyfus assembling his gang. We get almost a supercuts of him with all the 26 assassins coming after him. It does make me feel like there's huge sections of story from this removed in favor of, well, let's just cram as many jokes as we can into this one. And if 50% hits, it's the funniest Clouseau movie you've seen because we've thrown that many in them.
Yeah, it's sort of like you don't know what you've got till it's gone.
Yeah.
That I do not want to see the 3-hour cut of this movie where we're doing all of the meeting of every henchman and that kind of thing.
No.
But it does feel like it is just a strung together collection of gags, like a
cartoon
Naked Gun kind of movie, something like that.
Like, and you mentioned Wile E. Coyote. That's basically Roadrunner and Wile E. Coyote.
Yeah.
That's what that is. That is, I need to capture Roadrunner, and like for the next 25 minutes of this cartoon is just set piece. That's this.
And that's why I've got this weird dichotomy of like, what I think A Shot in the Dark is a better movie.
Yeah.
But I would rather watch
this
movie because it is just gag.
Yeah.
You know, take one breath and gag. And I think that Herbert Lom is terrific.
He is amazing. I told you, like he becomes the MVP of this series. He really is that good.
Yeah. Have you seen Confess Fletch yet?
No.
Okay.
Is that like based on Fletch?
Yeah.
No, I've never seen.
This is another one of those that kind of slipped under the radar because nobody was paying attention. And it's
when
just
did it
not
come out?
Yeah. You can find it on any of the streaming services now. Like, so it's John Hamm as Fletch.
Mad Men John Hamm.
Right. And it is it's not like the Chevy Chase Fletch. I mean, it's the same character, obviously.
Yeah.
It's not as goofy as those movies, but it's still a mystery comedy.
Oh, right.
And it's really, really good. And it reminds me, like, the difference is that like Fletch is not a bumbling idiot.
Yeah.
But it reminds me of that, like, that is sort of the pairing of mystery and comedy. Isn't, hey, we're going to have the mystery story, and then the comedy is going to be bumping into it in these particular scenes,
Yeah.
where, like, Confess Fletch is, oh, okay, well, the central character is funny. And so, as the mystery unfolds, you're going to follow this pretty funny character throughout the movie. And it's good. If you have any interest in the Fletch books or the movies or anything like that, you absolutely Confess Fletch is very funny. It's a good book. Directed by the guy who did Superbad,
Oh, right.
Greg
Well,
Mottola. So,
and then
yeah. So, like, it's got a good pedigree. I'll spoil one joke in Confess Fletch because it shows you what a child I am at heart. But there's a scene where the whole premise of the movie is that Fletch is investigating an art robbery, comes to this flat that he's renting in Boston, and finds a dead body and is under suspicion for murder for having killed this person he has discovered while he's simultaneously trying to solve this art mystery. Okay. And so it's a good mystery, but he's talking to the detective who is after him and initially thinks that he had something to do with the murder. And he says, like, hey, not only do we have the circumstantial evidence of you being found with the body, but there is also security footage from this shop around the corner. And Fletch goes, where the fudge is made? And it was one of those, like, throwaway jokes that I'm like, that is just childish enough to get me on board. But it's very good. It reminded me a lot of, like, what if Knives Out were more of a comedy? And so it's that kind of thing. But yeah, highly recommend it. But it is in the spirit of this kind of movie where the modern version of something like A Shot in the Dark is Confess Fletch, and the modern version of Strikes Again is Austin Powers.
Oh, 100%.
Because this is pure comedy.
And it leans heavily. And the next movie, so the next one we'll be doing is Revenge of the Pink Panther.
The last
And that
Sellers movie, yeah.
is the last one, and we kind of rein back a little bit. To be honest, there's more disguises in this one. There is a whole thing. There's a whole the whole end piece of it is amazing, where he basically does his version of Marlon Brando from The Godfather, which is fucking amazing. And he's surrounded by actual actors from mafia movies, like Robert Loggia is in it.
Oh, okay.
Like legit, like you like these guys are surrounding him as like proper mafioso guys. You've got Peter Sellers and the worst, like mothballs and the hey, it's like he's speaking what he thinks is Italian, but it's just like he says, hey, rigatoni, spaghetti, hey, come here.
All right.
Literally, it's a lot of fun. It's like the last hurrah before we really kind of fall off into a lot of movies which are going to try really, really hard, but just not going to be able to do the stuff that Sellers could do.
I'm kind of excited to get to those. I just want to see what they're like. And I'm even more excited to get to the Steve Martin films and see his interpretation of this.
They're like cartoon versions of Peter Sellers. They're not terrible. They're not terrible, but they're when you, I don't know. It's difficult for me to see, and you've seen it already. It's difficult for me to see anyone reboot that character. And at least Steve Martin is trying to be a kind of Peter Sellers-esque character, whereas our dude from a couple of movies ago was not.
Right,
Couldn't do
Alan
it.
Arkin. And yeah, we're getting, like, Roberto Benigni coming up and that kind
Yeah,
of, like,
playing
I'm
his son.
yeah
So, you know what I mean? Benigni
I
plays his son, which is actually that movie's fine. It's not great, but it's perfectly fine as a this is what Clouseau's son would be like, another bumbling idiot who kind of is like Clouseau, but not Clouseau, so we don't need to worry about it because he's the son of Clouseau, if you know what I mean.
yeah
It's kind of passable to an extent, but yeah, we've got an interesting road to toe. Those Steve Martin movies are really well cast, so that's the thing that they maybe have in their favor as like a credit point, is like they may not necessarily be the best movies, but they have good cast in them. So And we both like Steve Martin, so it's, yeah. it'll be fun to revisit them the first time since he came out. So,
well, you've heard it here first, folks.
Yep.
We are going to be doing next week is Revenge of the Pink Panther.
Yep, Revenge of the Pink Panther. So that's the last, like you say, it's rather, the last, yeah. Yeah, the last Sellers movie, and then we move to the trailer of the Pink Panther, which is the essentially the montage clip thing of all the stuff that they couldn't make because Sellers died. So they piece together a story where they're trying to track down Clouseau, who's went missing, mm-hmm. and they do it through lots of clips of them from outtakes of movies that were already there, and bringing back original cast members. So David Niven comes back in as the Phantom being interviewed. But he's weirdly, he's overdubbed. It's all weird. I think by then he was ill. He was very ill as well. So they actually overdubbed his voice for someone. But you get it's a weird montage. It doesn't really work. And it's kind of them trying to cash in on, it's a cynical cash grab to give people the kind of send off that they wanted to give Peter Sellers in the franchise. And then from there, it's, we just go a wee bit nuts until the end. So, yeah.
All right. Well, between now and then, Duncan.
Yes.
If people want to hear non Pink Panther stuff from you, which I can't imagine.
That's all I'm going to be talking about all November. So
it's Pink Panther-vember.
Yep. Oh, I like it.
So where can they find you and what will you be doing?
So check out Podcast Under the Stairs. This month I'm doing witch-themed movies. And also I'm drawing a Russian Roulette franchise retro, which will be running towards the end of November and right through December on the Bad Ben franchise. All 9 of those movies.
Really? That feels like something stupid I would have done.
It feels like something that I'm not getting a lot of volunteers for, Bo. So if you want to throw your name in it, I will happily put you in the...
Let me know. put me down for one of those.
Yeah, that's what I like to hear. So yeah, I'm doing that on the Teapots Collective. It's a lot of the same stuff, to be honest. All the regular shows are putting out regular stuff. You can find all of that at teapotscast.com or check out Teapots Collective or Podcast Under the Stairs wherever you're listening to your podcasts.
Ah, fantastic. If you want to hear more out of me, then be sure you subscribe to The Dark Parade, which is the podcast I do that is all things horror. You can also check me out on pick6movies.com, where this season we are calling Deja Ew, and it is a bunch of horror remakes. Basically, if Platinum Dunes released it in the early to mid 2000s, we are talking about it.
Nice.
just did that Elm Street remake, which continues to be a head scratcher.
Now that you recently rewatched The Hitcher and you realized how much of a great movie that is, if you haven't revisited that remake in a while, you should totally do that, because that is a bad fucking movie.
We haven't done that one. The next one we're doing is The Zombie Halloween. And then I'm trying to remember what the last one is. I'm just trying to block it out because we've done the Amityville remake, we did the Friday the 13th remake, we did Elm Street, Texas Chainsaw Massacre, just a murderer's row of movies that are incredibly forgettable. But at any rate, so you can find me there, and of course, Duncan and Bo Come Correct, which is the show you're listening to now, and all of those are available on legionpodcasts.com. And if you didn't listen to it, I referenced it early on. If you want to hear 31 mini reviews, just go to legionpodcast.com and search for the 31 days of Halloween, and you will get 3 years worth of, mini reviews. This last year was a lot of fun. I didn't do a lot of new stuff because, I'm in that stretch now where I'm catching up on the best of the year. That kind of stuff. So I finally got around to Barbarian, and holy shit, that movie's all right.
I still haven't seen it. It's only just been released over here, so it's just doing the rounds in the cinemas, so I will get a chance to see that. Some stuff, for whatever reason, is just not coming out in the UK this year, and I can't work out why. Like Pearl, for example, has not been released, which feels weird. Like that, because X was released and it did well in the UK, which to me feels like, and it's A24, so... I don't understand why that's not getting released over here.
Yeah, I think Barbarian was A24 as well.
Don't know.
Maybe. I don't know. I can't remember. It,
we'll just throw it on the list anyway.
It's fucking great. Barbarian's a real good time. And I'm sure you've heard this before, but just try to know as little as possible going into
it. Yeah, I know nothing about the movie. So I know who the cast is and that's it.
It's so. Yeah, it like it's not one of those things, like knowing the twist would not ruin the movie, but it's so much more fun if you don't know. Yeah, so that's great. So all right, well, we'll be back in 2 weeks to talk about more Pink Panther shenanigans.
Yeah.
And until then, the only thing left for me to do is to say to my old friend Duncan, say goodnight, Duncan.
To say to my old friend Duncan, say goodnight, Duncan.
It doesn't even work like that. I'm taking linguistics and it's
literally
doesn't...
what you asked me to do.
Not in that order.
I can't remember the thing.